Okay, welcome to session number 3 of module 1, in which we are discussing about stress and strain. So, in this session, we look at what is called as stress strain test. So, we discussed about stress and we discussed about strain. So, now we have one test called as stress strain test, by which we can find out the properties of the material. So, in the previous sessions, we have seen about the properties of the material. That properties we can understand, we can measure by doing one test called as stress strain test. So, here we have a machine or a setup by which we can apply load and we can measure the strain in the material. So, for any test we require what is called as a sample or a specimen. So, this is the test specimen for conducting what is called as stress strain test. This is also called as tensile test because we are applying tensile load on this specimen here. So, specimen is machined, or we take a material with particular shape and size according to some standards. So, to do any test or any experimental test has to be done, it has to be done according to some standards. So, standards will tell you about the specimen, how the specimen should be, what should be the shape, what should be the size of that specimen, and accordingly we prepare or we manufacture or we machine this particular specimen using a particular material for which we want to find out the properties, mechanical properties of the material. So, to know and to understand or to study about the mechanical behavior, or to understand or to know the mechanical properties of the material, we take that material and we prepare a tensile test specimen of particular shape and size according to some standards. We have ASTM standards, we have DIN standards, like that. We have Indian standards codes are there. But depending on different standards, we prepare this specimen. So, this is the specimen made up of some material for which I want to find out the mechanical properties. And this specimen is mounted or fixed in the machine which can do the testing. So, this machine as a whole, you can see this testing apparatus is called as UTM, or in simple words we call it as tensile testing machine, or simply we can call it as UTM, universal testing machine, because in this test different kinds of loads can be applied and you can find out different kinds of mechanical properties. So, here in this setup we will do only the tensile test, or what is called as stress strain test. So, this is also called as tensile testing machine. So, in this we will apply tensile load to the specimen and we will measure the strain from the specimen. So, we get stress and strain from this test. So, the load is nothing but you can convert the load into, load is because of the stress, load is, when you apply the load, we can calculate it as stress. When there is elongation, or when the material elongates elastically or plastically, that will measure that strain. So, this is also called as stress strain test, or simply tensile test. So, this is the specimen what we prepare before testing the, or before testing, before putting it in the, mounting it in the tensile UTM machine here. So, universal testing machine, this is there. So, the specimen you can see here, it is fixed here and one end is pulled here and other one will be pulled. So, you can apply load using this machine. We have some arrangements, hydraulically you can apply the tensile load on this material. And we have fixed an extensometer here. So, one extensometer will be fixed here to measure how much the specimen elongates for particular loads. So here the load is applied step by step. Different load grows on increasing slowly, and simultaneously how much the material elongates, that will be recorded by this extensometer. So this is a specimen, and this is how the specimen is mounted in the machine here. And this is after some application of the load, after some amount of load in the specimen, there will be at some point, at some place, at some cross section, the diameter will be reduced. This is called as necking. And as the load increases, the material will fracture. We can see that it will cut into two pieces here. So we'll study about this in detail later. So this is specimen, and you can see in the specimen we mark two points, and that is taken as the gauge length. So in the specimen, the length is marked in between in the middle of the specimen, and that is called as gauge length L. And the load is applied when you fix this specimen in this machine by the machine here. So load can be applied by when the machine works, when we apply the load hydraulically. And you can see here the threadings are made. It is nothing but gripping. It is for gripping the specimen inside these holders. So this is for gripping application. So whenever you make like this surface, it will grip inside this holder very easily and tightly, firmly. So we'll study about this detail later. So here, schematic diagram, you can see the specimen here. So this is the specimen. What you can see, the actual photo is here, and in schematic diagram, you can see this. You can see the specimen here in the schematic diagram. So two marks are made here on the specimen, and that is called as the gauge length. So this is the gauge length, original gauge length. And in this diagram you can see the specimen once necking has occurred and it is about to fracture. So you can see here the specimen at the middle, at the center, at any cross section, the cross section has decreased and it is about to fail or fracture. So as you apply the load slowly, what happens? The specimen elongates. You can see here the two dots, the original gauge length was here, and when you apply the load at the end of the at the maximum load, what happens? It is about to fail here. So you can see this or this mark or this dot, and it has extended here. So this was the original gauge length, and you can see from here to here it is called as gauge length at failure. So at when the specimen is about to fail, this mark has extended here. That means the specimen has extended from here to here. So this length is nothing but gauge length at failure. So originally the material was so much, specimen was so much, original gauge length. When you go on applying load, the material elongates, it has elongated, and it's a permanent elongation. So we call this as plastic deformation. So initially, when we apply the load, the material will elongate elastically, but when the load exceeds the yield point, it will elongate plastically, or it will deform plastically. So from the point on the specimen, initially it has moved from here to here. So this deformation or this elongation is permanent, and that's why I'm calling it as plastic deformation. Whereas this is the original gauge length, and from here to here this is the failure gauge length. So gauge length at failure. So here you can see in the schematic diagram the length has increased, and in this schematic diagram, so to maintain constant volume, when the length increases, the diameter should decrease. So lateral deformation also will be there. So this is the linear deformation. It elongates. So when the material elongates, it's a circular cross section, diameter should decrease. So here we can see the original diameter is here. This is the original diameter. When you apply the load, the material will elongate, the specimen will elongate. So the specimen elongates, diameter decreases. So you can see here, diameter has decreased from here to here. This is the diameter at failure. So this is the reduction in diameter, this dimension. So when you do a tensile test, you can find out or you can calculate how much elongation has been occurred in the tensile specimen. So you can calculate the elongation by this formula here. So increase in gauge length at fracture to the original gauge length. So this deformation, how much this deformation you can measure here, divided by the original gauge length, that will give you the percentage elongation of the specimen. So simultaneously, when the length increases, there should be reduction in diameter, so area. So there should be reduction in area also. So percent reduction in area will be again cross-sectional area of the necked portion. So how much reduction is there from original to area at the fracture, that difference divided by original area into 100, it will give the percentage reduction in area. So here you can see in the tensile test, the specimen elongates, so you can find out the percentage elongation. At the same time, when you apply the load, there will be reduction in diameter, so cross-sectional area will reduce, so you can calculate the percentage reduction in area. So schematically, you can see here, the photos you can see here, some photos of UTM, universal testing machine, or tensile testing machine, how that machine is designed, or that apparatus is set up to find out the, to do the testing on the specimens. So this is basically earlier days, this machine was called as UTM, and in this UTM, you can see this is a hydraulic mechanism is used to apply the load, tensile load or the compression load. So the in tensile load, the specimen will be fixed here, and the load will be this cross head will be moved up. So tensile load will be applied on the specimen when you fix the specimen here. If you want to do the bending test, the specimen will be put here. If you want to do the compression test also, you can keep the specimen and you can apply compressive load. That's why it is called as universal testing machine, because we can test tensile test, you can do the tensile test in the specimen, we can do the compressive test in this machine, and also we can do the bending test in this machine. That's why it's called as universal testing machine, UTM. So basically load was applied using hydraulic mechanism here, and recording, we used to get the data, that is extension and how much load is applied, that sustained curve, the diagram, we used to get it from this recorder here. But now as the computer advanced, so we could interface the computers to the machine using sensors, and could interact with the movements and the loads applied, and we can record how much load is applied and how much elongation is happening through this computer interface. So this is a modern UTM, and it works basically on electrical driven machine here. So electrically the load will be applied. We have screw drives here. So when the motor is switched on, because of the screw drive, this holder will move up and down. So we can apply tensile load or compressive load by using this electrically driven load application mechanism here. So in this modern UTM, load is applied by electrically driven motor, whereas in this UTM, old UTM, load is applied by this what is called as hydraulic mechanism here. We have hydraulic cylinders inside, and that will apply the load. But anyway, nowadays we use this modern UTM, and you can see here the specimen is fixed here, and in the computer we have a program, we have the setup app here, so in which we will be feeding, will be giving the initial gauge length and initial diameter to this app here, and in this application, when you give the input gauge length and diameter, and when you switch on the machine, the load will apply automatically. Slowly it will load starts, tensile load will be applied on the specimen, and at the same time in the computer it records how much load is applied and how much elongation is taking place. So we have sensors here, load sensors, and we have displacement sensors. So as the specimen elongates, that will be recorded here. So we get the what is called as stress strain curve or load versus elongation curve. Automatically it will be drawn while the test is being done. Then you can see one more bigger UTM here, industrial lab UTM. So these are all the different designs of UTMs based on their on the method on which the load is applied, elongation is measured, and how the output is the graph is drawn. So here you can see the UTM again, and you can see the tensile specimen here. It is zoomed here. So this is the tensile specimen. We have the holders grip, which are gripped. So specimen is gripped by these two holders, and you can see as you apply the load, the metal elongates, and you can see that the fracture. The specimen has broken into two pieces here. So it is fractured here. And in the computer, you can see here. So whenever we when you start applying the load, you start measuring the elongation also. So we draw the curve, load versus elongation. So in the y-axis we measure the load, 100 newton, 150 newton, 200 newton, like that. And in the x-axis we measure the elongation. So how much elongation specimen is being how much elongation that specimen is showing, that is taken, that is measured on the x-axis. So when you put the graph load versus elongation, or you can call it as stress versus strain, we get the curve like this. For particularly, this is for particularly mild steel. So we get this curve. We study about this curve later detail. So remember, whenever you do the tensile test in the UTM, we get the graph or the plot load versus elongation or stress versus strain curve. So this is called as stress strain curve or stress strain graph. So that graph we can see here, the plot. So in the y-axis I am measuring the load, and in the x-axis I am measuring the extension or elongation of the specimen. So load, you can, by using the formula stress force by area, load by the cross-sectional area of the specimen, we can calculate the, it will become stress here. So elongation is nothing but, it is a representative of the strain. So strain is nothing but elongation by original length. So this curve, this graph, when you do the test, tensile test, this curve or this graph is called as load versus elongation curve, or you can call it as stress strain curve. Because load is a part of the stress, so extension is a part of strain here. So you can call it as load versus elongation curve, or you can simply, generally we call this as stress strain curve. So this is particularly for mild steel. So here the specimen is mild steel. So when you do the test, when you apply the load on the mild steel in the UTM, initially the load is zero, strain is also zero. So the graph will be zero here at the initial point. And when you go on increasing the load, 0 newton, 10 newton, 20 newton, 50, 100, 200, 500, like that, the elongation also increases. So that data is taken, both load and elongation data is taken, and we plot this graph here. So whenever we do the test in this kind of UTM, that graph will be drawn by using this sheet, paper of sheet and pen, which will be mounted here. But nowadays we are using computerized UTM. So this graph will be drawn in the computer itself when the test is being done. So no need to calculate manually. So all the data will be taken from the UTM by this computer, and this computer will show this graph when the test is being done on the specimen. So this again, this is same as this graph only, just only is different kind of. This is just to show different properties, how to measure the different properties and what are the important points on this graph here. So this is a graph, Reston curve, and you can see some points are mentioned here and some description is being done for this graph. So this is the output of the tensile test. So whenever you do the tensile test, we get the, for example, whenever you do medical test, we get the report or we get the result. Similarly, whenever you do the tensile test, we get this result. So this data or this result, we have to analyze, we have to study. So this curve or this data will let us know what is the mechanical behavior of the material, or indirectly it will help us to understand what are the properties of the material when you do the tensile test on that material. And this curve, test strain curve or load stress elongation curve, it will be different for different materials. So the whatever result we get from the tensile test, that will be drawn in the form of this curve. And based on the nature of curve, we have to analyze, we have to interpret the properties of the material. So here you can see in this curve, many points are there and some description is being written to understand, to study the results, output of the testing, tensile testing. So first here, we'll start with the point A. So initially, you know, when the load increases, elongation also increases, and initially it is straight line, and we have some upside down increase and decreasing here, and again the curve, it increases and it comes down. So this is the nature of curve when the load is applied and when the extension is going on in the specimen. So here you can see initially when the load is applied, load is increased, the strain also increases, and it moves on straight, it is a straight line here. So here it is straight line here, and again the load increases, strain also increases, and again here you can see at this point here, at this point, the curve, the graph will change its nature from line to the curve. So here you can see at this position, at this region, as the load is increased, elongation also increases, and the graph will change its nature. That means it changes from linear or line to a curve. And you can see a curve increases, strain also increases, load also is increasing, and it will, at some point it will be maximum, load will be maximum, elongation is going on increasing here, and after some time, after some load, it will, graph will come down, and you can see a cross mark here. So here this point will indicate the fracture, the specimen will fracture at this load here. After this much amount of strain or elongation, so this point, this is the elongation of the specimen. So initially the length of the specimen was here, when the load started increasing and when it fractured, this is the amount of strain. So from here to here it has extended, the specimen has extended. And load, how much load you applied, you can see here maximum load you applied is at point E. So this is the maximum load applied. So here you can see the same curve, you can see here with values here. So this is stress or load, and this is strain or elongation. So in the y-axis you have taken the stress. So here you can see this is 20 megapascal, 40 megapascal or 60 megapascal, and this is the strain value. This is, you can see initially it is 0, load is 0, the stress is 0 and strain is 0. Load has increased. So when the load has increased, you can see here at around 40 megapascal, the strain is only so much, 0.0012. And when you increase the load here, you can, load has increased here, 0.02. Load is again increased, 60 megapascal, when the stress is 60 megapascal, the strain will be 0.2, like that. And again, when the load is maximum, the curve comes down and it fractures here, rupture. So rupture means fracturing, or the material fails, or it breaks into two pieces, the specimen. So that is called as the fracture. So this is the fracture load you can measure here, and this is the strain. So at fracture, the strain is 0.25. At fracture, at maximum load, the strain is 0.2. At this load, the strain is 0.00112, like that. So for each load, different loads or stresses, you can find out the you can find out the strain from this graph here. So here you can see here, as the initially when the load is zero, stress will be zero, strain will be zero. As the load increases, you can see here the strain goes on increasing, and we get a point at A. So this A is called as proportional limit. So you have understood the word proportional in the previous session. So you can see here why it is called as proportional, means until this point, from zero to this point, as the load increases, strain also increases linearly. So the relationship between stress and strain is linear here, proportional. So that's why it is called as proportional limit. So as the load increases, strain also increases linearly. So the graph is linear. So stress is proportional to strain from here to point A. That's why that A is called as proportional limit. So until this point A, the stress is proportional to strain. So it is called as proportional limit. So this is the limit. So below this, it is a line here. That means load is proportional to strain. Then come to point B. This is called as elastic limit. So I told you that when you apply the load, the load is increased on the specimen, it elongates. So initially the metal will elongate elastically. So that is called as elastic deformation. And until point B, when you apply the load, the metal will get elongated. And at point B, when you remove the load, at point B, when the load is removed, suppose you remove the load, the strain will come back to zero. So that's why it is called as elastic deformation, or that point B is called an elastic limit. It means if you take this load here, if you measure the load here, so this B, it is called as elastic load. Okay, this point B load is elastic load, and this strain is elastic strain. So at point B, you remove the load, the specimen will come back to original length. So that is initially called as, that deformation is called as elastic deformation. We discussed it in the previous sessions also. So whenever you apply load on the specimen or the material, remember that initially there will be elastic deformation. So when you remove the load at that point, the elongation will come back to the original length. That's why it is called as elastic deformation. So until point B, you apply the load, the strain will be there, and when you remove the load at point B, the strain will come to zero. So that deformation is called as elastic deformation of the material. So this is the limit. So until this load, the metal will deform elastically. So this is a deformation. Strain means deformation or elongation or extension, all are same. Then again, as you go on increasing the load, we get a point. You can see here the nature of curve will change. That means it will change from line to a curvature here. So this point C is called as yield point or yield load. So this point C, the load at point C is called as yield load. So yield means bending or deformation or deforming permanently, yielding. So that's why the word yield is there. So at this point C, that is at load C, the metal will start deforming plastically. That means when you apply the load at C and remove the load, the metal will not come back to original length because it has undergone permanent deformation or plastic deformation. So this point C, where the curve changes, where the graph changes from line to curve, that is called as yield point. And particularly in mild steel, this graph is for particularly mild steel. So in mild steel, you can see the curve increases, and for slight at some particular position, it comes down, then it increases. So we take this as yield point 1 and 2. So once C is above and D is below, the load is decreases slowly, lightly it decreases at from C to D. The load is decreases at this point. So this is because particularly in melt steel, it is observed that a small amount of nitrogen will be there, and that causes this yield point phenomena in the melt steel, wherein we have two yield points, upper yield point and lower yield points, C and D. So this is particularly in melt steel, and it is studied that it is because of a small amount of nitrogen in melt steel. That's again microstructure. Let's not go in detail about that. So just remember, in melt steel we have two yield points. One is upper yield point and other one is the lower yield point. So from this load, when you increase the load, the metal will elongate plastically. So this is the plastic deformation. From D, plastic deformation starts. So from 0 to D, this is the elastic deformation. From D to F, that is the plastic deformation. So you can see here, from 0 to D, this is elastic region. So this is all elastic region. And from D, this is the plastic deformation or plastic region. We call this as plastic region. So this is how the graph is analyzed. So this is only the how we study or how we interpret the results of tensile test. So whenever you do the tensile test, these points will be observed in the melt steel specimen. So here you can see, from here to here it is elastic deformation. Until this C, it is elastic deformation. From C to F, it is called as plastic deformation, or you can call this as plastic region or elastic region. So this is the how the graph is studied when the tensile test is done. And you can see the load is increased to C, and after this C, the line will become a curve. It grows on increasing. So you can see the load goes on increasing. Load is increasing now. Load is increasing. And when the load increases to point E, so the load is maximum here. So this is the, you can find out what, how much value is this. So this is the maximum load or ultimate load in the curve. So, and you can see the load reaches maximum here. So at this point, what happens to the specimen is, at this point, when the load reaches maximum here, what happens to the specimen is, the at some cross section in the specimen, you can see this reduction in diameter. So the cross sectional diameter will reduce. So this is called as necking. So this forms a neck in the specimen. So it is called as necking phenomena. So this occurs at the maximum load of the when you apply maximum load on the material. So that maximum load is decided by the material, inherent material property. That is the maximum capacity. So that much load it can take for plastic deformation. So when the load reaches maximum point E, the necking occurs here. So when the load reaches maximum here, so depending on the strength of different materials, the load, maximum load will be decided. So when the load reaches maximum, that means the material doesn't have much strength to hold that load. So what happens? It deforms plastically, and the necking will occur in the specimen. So when the necking occurs, diameter will decrease. So the specimen no longer can take more loads. So the load decreases now suddenly, and after some amount of strain, it will fracture. It will fail. So this is called as fracture load. So when you find the value of this F here, so this will give the fracture load or fracture stress. So when you find out the value of E, at this load is called as the ultimate load or maximum load. So this is maximum load, or this is the fracture strength, fracture load. So that load, point E, is called as maximum load or the ultimate load. and load divided by that area, that will give the strength. So that point T is also called as ultimate strength of the material. Point F is called as fracture load or fracture strength of that material. Similarly, point C is called as upper yield point, or we simply called it as yield strength or yield stress in the material. So this is the yield strength. So all the loads are, we can call it as strength or stress. So yield stress is there, or yield strength. So this is point C is the yield strength of the material. So that means yield means to deform plastically. So here the material, the property changes from elastic deformation to plastic deformation. So the same we can see in terms of values here. So this is, this graph you can see, this curve is for carbon steel, low carbon steel, particularly mild steel. And you can see the same tensile test curve, test strain curve, and this is for aluminium alloy. So I told you that here you can see initially it is linear and it goes on to become curvier. So unlike in mild steel or low carbon steel, we don't have this upper yield point and lower yield point in this aluminium alloys. So different materials, they show different curves like this, and you have to understand the curve, and in all the curves these points will be there, and you have to understand, you have to study those curve, and you have to understand how much elastic deformation is there, how much plastic deformation is there. So you can see steel and aluminium, they are showing more amount of plastic deformation, you can see here. So this is for aluminium. So in aluminium we don't see upper yield point and lower yield point. There is only one yield point here, and that is seen, it is understood by looking at the nature of this graph. So initially it is straight until here, and again it becomes a curve. So this point where the graph changes from a line to the curve, that point is taken as yield point, sigma y, or yield strength of that material. So this is the yield strength of this mild steel. So this is the yield strength of this aluminium. So it is 40 here, 20 here, so around 35. So the yield strength of this aluminium is 35 KSI. So this is the units here. Okay. So again you can see the same graph here. So this is called a stress strain curve or stress strain graph or stress strain graph for mild steel. So this is again for mild steel. So here you can see the values are given. So in the previous graph values were not there, just so it was general here, and in this case actual values are given, the load is given, and the load divided by area, that is taken as stress, and it is given in Newton per millimeter square. So here you can see this is the stress 50 newton, 50 megapascal, 100 megapascal, 150 megapascal, 200 250. So here you can see the yield strength of the yield strength is here, yield load is here, or yield stress is here, or yield strength sigma y of this mild steel is 250 megapascal. So this is the yield strength. That means at this load, at this stress, the mild steel will elongate plastically, will deform plastically. So until here, from here to here, from 0 to here, it is elastic deformation. From here to here, it is plastic deformation. So you can see after the yield stress or yield load, the graph will become a curve. It increases to maximum load here. So this is the maximum stress or maximum strength of mild steel, or ultimate strength of mild steel. So ultimate strength of mild steel is, you just go to this y-axis, so around 420 or around 420 or 425, so that is the maximum stress or maximum strength of mild steel, or we can call it as ultimate strength. So ultimate strength of this mild steel is 425 megapascal. Yield strength of mild steel is around 250, so this is around 250 megapascal. Ultimate strength is, maximum strength is 425 megapascal. So from this graph we can find out the actual properties of the material, and strain is given here, this is the elongation, or you can calculate it as strain. In percentage it is given, 5%, 10%, like that. So 0.05, 0.1, 0.15 strain is here. And after the maximum load, the cross-sectional area will decrease, so it cannot take more, no more load. Load decreases, but elongation will be there. From here to here, elongation will be there, and it will fracture here. So it is breaking. So this is called as fracture stress or breaking stress, or simply fracture strength of this material. So at this stress or at this load, that is around 310 megapascal, at this stress it will fracture. So when the load, when the stress or when the load is around 310 megapascal, the metal will, the strain, that material specimen will fracture. So here you can see the schematic diagram. When the test is being done, on the left hand side you can see how the material, when it is tested, how it changes the shape and size. At the same time, right hand side, how the graph is drawn, load versus elongation. So this is load or stress, this is elongation or strain. So initially you can see this is the initial gauge length, yellow. So the load is not applied now. So when the load is started applying, the length increases. So you can see in the diagram, the length of the specimen has increased. So at this point, you can see the strain. So length has increased, strain has increased. So you can come back to this line in the diagram. You can see the strain here is so much. So at this point, it is the yield strength. So that means when the metal is like this, when you remove the load, it will come back to original length up till this load. When the stress or load increases beyond this point, that will cause plastic deformation or plastic strain. So only until this load or until this stress, when you remove the load at this point, the material will come back to initial length. The deformation will come down. That deformation is called as elastic deformation. So after this load, above this load, when you increase the load, what happens? The stress will be more, and when you remove the load also, the metal will not come back to original length, so it deforms plastically. So from here, all the deformation is called as plastic deformation or plastic strain. And again, in plastic deformation, you can see this curve is uniform, so we call this as uniform plastic deformation. After this, it suddenly decreases, so it is called as non-uniform deformation. So you can see as the load increases, at this point it is yielding, so yielding has occurred starting. That means plastic deformation starts here. When the load increases, when as you increase the load, the length of the specimen, that is strain, increases from here to here. At the same time, the stress in the metal also increases, so stress is increasing, load is increasing. So at this maximum load, what happens? The cross section will reduce here. You can see here, it has become thin here. So that phenomena is called as necking. So at this load, at this stress, what is called ultimate tensile strength or ultimate tensile stress, at this stress, necking will occur. The area diameter of that specimen will reduce. So this is the yield strength or yield stress. So at this load, this is called as yield stress or yield strength. At this load, maximum load, it is called as ultimate strength or ultimate stress. So since it is tensile, we call this as ultimate tensile strength. If it is compressive, we call this as compressive strength. So strength or stress you can use, no problem. So both are same here. So strength indicates maximum stress or the limiting stress. So when the ultimate stress is there, it is called as ultimate strength. So this is the yield strength. And after this it will fracture, that is called as fracture strength. So you can see how the specimen changes and simultaneously how the graph is drawn here by taking load in the y-axis and the strain or elongation in the x-axis. So here you can see this is the yield strength, this is the ultimate strength, this is the fracture strength, and here this is the elastic deformation or elastic strain until the yield strength. then from yield strength, from the yielding, from the yield strength to this fracture, that strain is called as plastic strain or plastic deformation. And we talked about Young's modulus. So initially in elastic deformation, the stress is linearly proportional to strain. That's what is Hooke's law or the Young's modulus. So Young's modulus is nothing but stress by strain. So if you measure the stress divided by this strain, so much of strain, that gives the Young's modulus. So Young's modulus is in the graph is nothing but slope of this line. So Young's modulus you can measure or you can calculate by measuring the slope of this line. So how do we measure the slope of this line, straight line? So we draw a triangle here and we take this as angle theta. So tan of theta is called as the slope of this line. So tan of this angle will give the slope of this line. So mathematically you can measure the stress here, this much of stress, and you can measure this much of strain. So that the stress by strain will give the Young's modulus E, or modulus of elasticity. So you can calculate modulus of elasticity in the elastic region. You can calculate the slope of this line. It's nothing but stress by strain. So mathematically we'll get the, you can measure the slope by using these two values of stress and these two values of strain, and the tan of theta will give the slope of this line, stress by strain. That is called as modulus of elasticity. That we'll see later when we solve the problems, how to calculate modulus of elasticity from this graph. So here you can see the same graphs are again shown here with some more details. So you can again understand, analyze in detail here. So this graph you can see here, this is for aluminium. So this stress strain curve is for aluminium. So here you can see there is no what is called as yield strength, two yield strength, upper and lower yield strength is not there. Initially it is straight line, then it becomes a curve. So we cannot in this aluminium or in some or in materials which show this kind of stress strain curve, we cannot identify exact point where the curve or where the graph changes from line to curve. So here we use one phenomena, one understanding called as offset yield strength. So in offset yield strength, what we are doing is we take the strain. Here you can see the same graph is magnified here. So we take a strain of around 0.2%. We take a strain of 0.2%. So this is the 0.2% strain, that is 0.002 strain we measure from 0 to here, and that is 0.002 strain. And from this point we draw a straight line parallel to this line. So we take 0.2% strain here, we measure 0.002 strain here, and from this point we draw a line parallel to this line. You can see here, you can see here. So when you draw a line parallel to this line, it will touch the curve at some point. So when you draw a straight line, it will touch this curve at this point. So this point is called as 0.2% offset yield strength of the material. So this is the stress or strength, yield strength at this point. So this yield strength is called as 0.2% yield strength. So this is particularly, this 0.2% offset yield strength is taken particularly when the in the materials which show stress strain graph wherein there is no upper and lower yield strength. So we don't know whether to take the yield strength here. So what we do is we take 0.2% strain, we draw a straight line parallel to this line, and it touches the curve here. So that stress or that strength is taken as the yield strength of this material. So this is particularly seen in aluminium and other non-ferrous materials. So this is called as 0.2% yield strength, offset yield strength. Whereas in Melchizedek we have upper yield strength and lower yield strength. And here you can see the succession curve or succession diagrams for different materials. So this is the mild steel, just now we saw that, and this is for cast iron and this is for concrete. So here cast iron and concrete, you can see the nature of succession curve is different than this. So basically by looking at the succession curve, we can say whether the material is ductile or brittle. So from this diagram we can say that mild steel is ductile, whereas cast iron and concrete, they are brittle, because cast iron and concrete, they don't show the plastic deformation. That's why they are called as brittle materials. So in brittle materials, there is no much plastic deformation or zero plastic deformation. They deform only elastically. So that's why they are called as brittle materials. Example, cast iron and concrete. Even glass, also the succession curve will be like this. When you apply load on the cast iron and concrete, they deform elastically until some load, until the yield load or the maximum load, and after that they fracture suddenly. That is the nature of brittle fracture. That's why it's called as stress strain diagrams for brittle materials. So this is the cast iron and concrete, they are brittle materials. Mild steel is the ductile material. So the plastic deformation in mild steel is more than the cast iron or concrete. So here you can see the specimens when they fracture. So by looking at the surfaces, we can say whether the material is ductile or brittle. So you can observe there that this is called as ductile fracture, this is called as brittle fracture. Before that, you can see the succession diagram for ductile material like steel, aluminium. So this is the succession curve for ductile materials, and this is the succession curve or succession diagram for brittle material. So here you can see in brittle materials there is only elastic deformation. This much amount of elastic deformation is there, and there is no much or there is no plastic deformation in the brittle materials. The curve stops here, it fractures here, the metal fractures here. And whereas in ductile materials you can see the curve, it goes on increasing. That means the strain or deformation goes on increasing. So there is a plastic deformation, large amount of plastic deformation is there in some materials. That's why they are called as ductile materials. And in the materials where the plastic deformation is less or zero, those materials are called as brittle. So cast iron, glass, concrete, ceramics, they are all called as brittle materials. Whereas steel, aluminium, copper, those metals are called as ductile materials. So by looking at the deformation, we can classify the metals as ductile or brittle. So ductile means those materials which show large amount of plastic deformation, they are called as ductile. The materials which show less or nil plastic deformation, they are called as brittle materials. And when the fracture has occurred in the specimen, by looking at the nature of these surfaces, fractured surfaces, we can say that whether the material has failed by ductile or by brittle fracture. So in the ductile materials, for example steel or aluminium, when you look at the surfaces after fracture, you can see one end it is elongated and in one end it is depression will be there. So this is called as cup and cone fracture. So this is just like a cup. So one end, one surface will show cup like surface, and in the other end, other part of the material, it shows elongated or cone like structure here. This is because plastic deformation necking will be there here. Because of this necking, and large amount of positive formation, the metals, the bonds, atomic bonds will not break very easily because of the high strength or because of the ductile nature. So this fracture, by looking at the surface, it is called as ductile fracture, and we call this as cup and cone fracture. And this is, you can see the surface here, it is plain surface, there is no deformation, partial deformation here, no, there is no reduction in diameter also, and that's why it is called as brittle fracture. So by looking at how the fracture surface, or by looking at the fracture surfaces, we can say the metal has failed by brittleness or by ductileness, or we can say whether that metal is ductile, or the, we can say whether that metal is brittle. So you can see this is a ductile fracture, or this, sorry, this is a brittle fracture. You can see the surfaces are plain, and in ductile fracture it has elongated and the diameter has reduced here. You can see that in the diagram here. So in this diagram, this is initial specimen. The metal has failed without any, without much, without necking or without much partial deformation. That fracture is called as brittle fracture. Whereas in this specimen, you can see necking has occurred, and you can see the metal has failed here, and you can see the surface has, again, it is very much sharp here. So this is ductile fracture, and here ductility is more. So here the ductility is more. So you can see that ductile materials, in ductile materials, again, the amount of plastic deformation may be less or more. So this is, deformation is there, plastic deformation is there, but it is less compared to this diagram here. Here the deformation, plastic deformation is more compared to this. But anyway, these two are ductile materials, where the amount of ductility is more in this diagram compared to this diagram. And this is brittle fracture. And some examples you can see, for example, you take a pencil and just simply bend it, it will fracture, it will not deform plastically. So that is a brittle material. And you can see the, it is a steel fence. This is a ductile material, you just pull it, it will elongate. And plastic material is also there, so this is also a ductile material. It will not fracture suddenly, it will elongate. So you can see, you can compare the ductile fracture versus brittle fracture. So ductile materials or ductile fracture are metals which fail by ductile nature. They can be drawn into wires. So you can see here, for example, copper and aluminium, we can easily draw them into wires because there is large amount of plastic deformation. And ductile materials show deformation, so we just discussed about that. In ductile materials, the plastic deformation is more, whereas in brittle materials, plastic deformation is not there. And in brittle materials, they break or crack very easily. Whereas in ductile metals, crack will not be there initially. Crack will be there, crack occurs only after large amount of plastic deformation. And ductility is affected by temperature. So when the temperature increases, ductility also increases. And brittleness is affected by the pressure. And examples, you can see metals, usually all the metals are ductile materials, whereas ceramics or glasses, they are brittle materials. They break very easily. And you can see one more understanding you can see from the section curve is that the area under this curve, if you calculate the area, if you measure the, if you calculate the area under this curve, that will give you the amount of energy absorbed by this material. It's called as absorbed energy. So if you measure, if you calculate the area under this curve from here to here, if you measure this area, that will give you the how much amount of energy is absorbed by the material. So you can see the area under this ductile material curve is more compared to the brittle material. This is only this much area is there until it fractures. So that means ductile materials will absorb more energy. That means it will take more and more energy because of the partial deformation before it fractures. Whereas brittle metals, they don't absorb much of energy before the fracture. That's why in ceramics and glasses, they break very easily compared to metals. So I told you that whenever you take a sheet metal, aluminium sheet metal, and hit it with a hammer or a stone, it will undergo partial deformation and dent will be formed. Whereas if you throw a stone or hammer, a glass or a tile or a concrete, it will fracture, it will crack up, it will fracture very easily. So that means it will not absorb much energy. So brittle materials, they don't absorb much energy, whereas ductile metals, they absorb more energy before they fail, before the fracture. So from the Shesterton diagram, you can calculate how much energy the metal will absorb. So if you calculate the area under this curve, that area will give you the how much energy is absorbed by that material. And you can see in ductile material, the absorbed energy is more, area is more. Whereas in brittle materials, the area is less. That means the energy absorbed by that material is less. So here we have the same Shesterton diagram is there, and I told you that the stress what you calculate, it is called as engineering stress, and the strain what you calculate is engineering strain. So this is again stress versus strain diagram for different materials. So you can see when the material in the materials or in the metals, when the elongation is less than 5%. So we discuss about this elongation. So if the elongation is less than 5%, those metals are called as brittle materials. When the elongation is more than 8%, those metals are called as ductile materials. So how to calculate elongation? We have seen it by this formula. Percentage elongation is the change in the elongation divided by original length into 100. That will give the percentage elongation. So we can classify based on the elongation or based on the partial deformation, you can classify the metal as brittle and or ductile. If the elongation is less than 5%, it is brittle. Elongation more than 8%, it is ductile. So here you can see we have different graphs for different materials. We have different Shesterton diagram. So this is an aluminium, or this is some other material, steel. This is brittle material, say cast iron. This is, you can say, glass. So A and B, the graph we can see, A and B, I can say that these two materials are brittle materials. By looking at the graph, Shesterton diagram, I can say that A and B are brittle materials. Whereas metal C and D, by looking at the graph, because by looking at the strain, by looking at the partial deformation, I can say that C and D are ductile materials. So you can see here, the metals A and D are brittle because the strain or partial deformation is less compared to C and D, and because in C and D partial deformation is more. You can see here so much of deformation is there. So from year to year partial deformation is there. So that's why C and D are ductile materials, A and B are brittle materials. So you can see from the tensile test, we can calculate different properties of the material. So I told you we can calculate the Young's modulus, we can calculate the ultimate tensile strength, we can calculate 0.2% yield strength, we can calculate elongation, we can calculate so the density and fatigue, you cannot get it from tensile strength. So these are again properties, we will see about this later. So all these things, all these properties like elongation, yield strength, ultimate strength, modulus of elasticity, we can calculate from the Shesterton diagram or by doing tensile test. And you can see different properties are given for different materials in this table. So for example, in medium carbon steel, Young's modulus is 200 GPa, ultimate strength is 520 MPa, and yield strength is 310 MPa. Whereas for aluminium alloys, you can see Young's modulus is less compared to steel, and also ultimate tensile strength is less compared to steel, Wheel strength is also less compared to steel. So like that we have different titanium alloys are there, composites are there, wood is there. We can compare the yield strength of, Young's modulus of wood with steel. So wood, Young's modulus is very less compared to steel. And yield strength of wood is less compared to steel. Ultimate strength is only 100 megapascal compared to steel of with 520 megapascal. So you can see here in the table different metals are there and the properties are given here. And all this data you can get it from tensile test. When you do the tensile test, we calculate all these properties of the material. And again you can see here Young's modulus, yield strength and ultimate strength for different materials is given in this table. You can compare the strength of different materials. So aluminium you can see it's only 20 megapascal, yield strength is only 20 megapascal, whereas titanium it is 100 megapascal, tungsten is 550 megapascal, like that. Iron is again 100 megapascal. So this is the yield strength. These are the yield strength of different materials. These are the ultimate strength or maximum loads of these materials. Similarly, again, we have one more table. Again, it gives different properties of different materials. So these are all different materials. Steel, stainless steel, iron, brass, all that are there. And these are the yield strength in megapascal, ultimate strength in megapascal. And this is the energy absorbed. I told you that area under the car will give the energy absorbed by the material. So modulus of resilience. So modulus of resilience is area under the elastic region, area in the elastic region, whereas modulus of toughness is area under the curve until fracture. So this is toughness and this is resilience. So this area under the curve until fracture is called as toughness, whereas area under the elastic curve, the elastic limit, that is called as the resilience. So resilience and toughness, they are the properties. So resilience is energy absorbed in the elastic region, whereas toughness is the energy absorbed until fracture. So that is resilience and toughness. So here you can see resilience is less compared to toughness, because resilience it indicates only the energy absorbed in the elastic region. So it will be less, it's only 186, whereas toughness is the energy absorbed until fracture in the plastic region. So both the elastic plus plastic deformation, that area that is energy absorbed, it will be more. You can see it is 128,755 kilojoules per meter cube. So meter cube is the volume of the material, and this is the kilojoules or joules is the energy absorbed. So modulus of resilience is energy absorbed per volume of the material. Toughness is again energy absorbed per volume of the material. So you can see modulus of resilience is very less compared to modulus of toughness. The toughness is until fracture, energy absorbed until fracture, whereas resilience is energy absorbed in the elastic region of the sustained curve. Thank you. So that's it for this session. We look at some more details in the next sessions. Thank you.